In this video, I'm going to talk about this book, The Ethics of Human Enhancement, Understanding the Debate. So let me start with a story. It was a couple of months ago and I was running a 10K race. Oh, and it hurt so much and I was breathing and my heart was pounding. But in the end, with a lot of pain, I made it to the finish line and there it was, a PR on my race. I had like 43 minutes and a couple of seconds. And I was really striving to, for the first time, to go under the 44 minutes. And when I got home that day, I wondered why, because I was also still in the concept of human enhancement, I was thinking, well, what if I had synthetic blood and doping and bionic legs? And I would run this race in 30 minutes or 20 minutes, would it have the same kind of feeling of accomplishment for that? So, and that's also one of the things in the book, The Ethics of Human Enhancement. It's a book from 2016. It's been co-edited by a couple of scholars. So it's not a book in a general sense. The book contains of chapters, but each chapter is like an article or essay by a scholar. So it's edited by a couple of other scholars, Julian Savulescu. I'd like to look at the names because I know Julian Savulescu, I interviewed him, but also Steve Clark, C.A.J. Cody, Alberto Giobini, and Sagar Sanyal. And the book contains of two sections, and the first section contains chapters about understanding the debate, so it's more the groundworks, and the second section is about advancing the debate. So what I think is really important is the subtitle of the book, so the title is The Ethics of Human Enhancement and the subtitle is Understanding the Debate. So in this book you see a lot of arguments being made against human enhancement and also arguments being made in favor of human enhancement. So let's start. What is human enhancement actually? And I like to quote from the book, human enhancement in bioethics. The term human enhancement refers to any kind of genetic, biomedical, or pharmaceutical intervention aimed at improving human dispositions, capacities, and well-being, even when there's no pathology to be treated. So it's like when you have a pacemaker or when you take a certain type of medicine against a disease, that's not called human enhancement. And also when you're driving a car instead of running a 10K and you can drive it, that's also not called human enhancement. Because it's really aimed at directly the human capabilities with the aim to improve it. So to come back to the running example, when I do not need bionic legs, because I still have my biological legs, but I have sort of an upgrade, then it's called human enhancement. Or when I take doping, while there's no like EPO, while there's no like, while I'm not a patient, that's also called human enhancement. These are physical examples, but you can also think of certain nootropics. These are pharmaceuticals to increase your cognition or your focus or your memory. You can also call these kinds of things human enhancement because it's like for a healthy person with the aim to increase their capabilities. And one of the things I found really interesting in this book is the different approaches it has on looking at human enhancement or the ethics of human enhancement. And they have two examples, for example, the non-medicine approach and the welfareist approach. And the non-medicine approach takes a distinction between therapy and enhancement to be factually and morally important, while the welfareist approach sees the normality that medicine aims to restore as a merely statistical notion, subject to change over time with no moral significance. And this is I think a really important point, which I get into later also in talking about the discussion and also about the solution. And you can say it's more of a difference between how you look at the human body and increasing our capabilities. Is it something that's more fixed or is it something that's more fluid and changeable over time? So in the book, there's a lot of attention for the arguments of critics for against human enhancement, you might say. For example, Francis Fukuyama, who's on the left, Professor Michael Sandel, and Leon Kass. They're also influential critics of human enhancement. And they make a lot of arguments. And so in some of the articles in the book or chapters, they get into the arguments and they say, well, is it a valid argument or not? But I like to mention the arguments for you. For example, you can think of autonomy, and that's the idea when somebody else makes a decision for you to be enhanced. Your parents, think of genetically engineering embryos, or maybe your employer or the state. So they say it's really important to keep the autonomy of an individual. Well, I agree with that point. But also, what's interesting arguments like what is actually a good life, and do you need human enhancement for that? Do you need to enhance a certain area of your body to live a better life? In the case of patients and diseases, I would say the answer is yes. But like I mentioned, that's not called human enhancement. That's just normal, regular medicine. And what's a good life is also. Looks a little bit like another argument, which is about factor X, that's made by Francis Fukuyama, who says it's really difficult to pinpoint at what is the essence of what makes us human. So if we start tingling and altering and changing the human body, maybe we change something we do not want to change. That's called the factor X. And another argument is that it could lead to a divide in society. Because these kinds of upgrades, human enhancement technologies, are only available for the rich. So the rich people are able maybe to live longer, to increase their physical capabilities, to increase their cognition, so can they have better jobs, and that leads to a further widening of the gap. What was interesting is that in this book, they also made arguments against arguments, if you can still follow me. And one of the things I think is really interesting is that they say, well, the way we look at a certain technology or certain human enhancement changes over time. They make the case of in vitro fertilization. When it was first introduced, there was a lot of discussion, heated discussion, and also people really opposed against IVF. And right now that kind of changed and the opposition faded away. And also that culture and time changes our perception. So that also relates to the welfarist approach where I talked about. That institutions who look at these technologies, they are also prone to cognitive biases. So they make the statement, in this case, they're Roach and Clark in 2019, that you have to look at these arguments also with that idea that they might be prone to cognitive biases. On the other hand, I think this is not a really good argument, because you can also say, of course, about the people who are in favor of human enhancement, that they may be also prone to the same kind of cognitive biases. So what about the proponents of human enhancement? There are a couple. Like I mentioned, one of the editors of this book is Professor Julian Savulescu. And I also interviewed Julian Savulescu for my YouTube channel earlier, so a link is down below. And I'd like to mention three interesting concepts from the proponents of human enhancement. The first is that they say the use of technology is what makes us human. So think about contact lenses or glasses or clothes, or also maybe having a pacemaker. That is what makes us human. So maybe some things are now a little bit sci-fi, science fiction, but in the future it's just normal part of what makes us human. Another thing which I think is really interesting point ethically is procreative beneficence. That's where he states, if you have children as parents, you want to have the best upbringing for them, the best conditions. So he says, well, of course, that all the risks are taken care of. It's your moral obligation to have children with the best opportunities, so the best cognition, the best physical capabilities. So that's the idea, that's an interesting idea, I think. And that's also something I think really gets the conversation starting. Also, if you compare it to the arguments that are made by critics that say also say the use of human enhancement makes us to play God. So what if a child is born? Are the opportunities open, or do you want to have a say in how the child, with what kind of start point the child has in life? Well, another point, the third point, which is interesting, I think, is of moral enhancement, where he states, well, a lot of problems we have right now, like climate crisis and crime, these kinds of things. We do not need cognition to be boosted or our physical capabilities to be better, but we need moral enhancement, so we are better for each other and the world. And that's, of course, contradicts maybe at first sight the idea of autonomy. So I think that's really an interesting philosophical idea. And this whole book is really in depth. It's written by researchers, but really makes you think about these concepts. So what about the solution? There were also some notes I took, which I think really struck chord with me. One, for example, is about cultures. That's an argument which has been made by James Canton, that he states that, well, it's really maybe in the Western world, because I live in the Netherlands, we have a certain idea of what human enhancement is, but that's different in other cultures. And it's difficult to talk about this is human enhancement, because enhancement means something else for a different person. And it also aligns with another thing I noted. It's the concept of the moderate pluralist made by Seljulid. And he proposes investigating principled ways of balancing or trading off the different concerns. So you look at a certain enhancement technology, like the bionic legs, for example, for running. And then you say how great the equality or utility cost of enhancement would be in order for liberty infringement to be justified. So you make a more case-by-case analysis. And I think that's really important. And that's also an argument being made by about wisdom, that I think with the use of these technologies, we have a lot of opportunities, but we also need to have a break and have experience with these kinds of methods and take the time to reflect on them. Otherwise, it could lead to one of the arguments that critics made, that we go too fast and that we maybe lose something which is very essential for us as humans. And that's also my verdict. So I think you cannot say that you're against human enhancement or in favor of human enhancement, but you have to look at it from case to case and think of for yourself, what are the benefits? Does it make a good life? Is it my factor X? Or do you really need an enhancement? And also, what is the impact of when I use it on the people around me, maybe also on society and the world around us? And that also is the idea of rich bioethics that's really resonated with me. And that's an alternative to the instrumental approach, as the author stated. Rich bioethics or substantive bioethics extends the discussion to identifying and assessing implicit ends of certain uses of technology. So that really makes you think about, okay, with bionic legs, I can run faster, but what are other possible things that could happen, which I am not aware of at this moment? So I really think for that we need time, we need experience, we need to see experiments also to see how these things are going to, really what kind of impact it has on the world. So to summarize, this book, or I should say Bundle, The Ethics of Human Enhancement, I would say it's a must read if you're into this domain, if you're studying the ethics of human enhancement. I think it's not really that accessible for lay people. So if you want to have general start. I would advise other books. If you have a question about it, leave a comment down below. But I think it's really interesting that it really gets into the weeds, really into the details of certain arguments in favor and against of the ethics of human enhancement. So I really liked reading it, and I think also for my next videos and articles I will look at the notes a couple of times more, because there are a lot of wisdom in this book. And yeah, wisdom we need for the future of ourselves as human beings and the future of human enhancement. So thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. You can go to my website superhumantalks.com, where you can find a free download and also find more information about my services, like giving webinars, keynotes, consultancy. And also, do not forget to leave a comment down below if you have questions about the ethics of human enhancement, or have a question, or did you read the book yourself. And also, do not forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Thanks.